This one's about chasing the light. So I'll be talking about things like the position of the light, where it should be, generally speaking. And just remember, when I'm talking about something, if I use the word rule, a rule is really a guideline in photography. I'd certainly suggest when you're starting out that you follow the rules or guidelines. But as your skills develop and as you start to understand what happens, experiment. So if I say shoot and don't shoot into the sun, absolutely you should, because you need to learn what it does. You need to learn what the effects are and how you can use that creatively. We'll talk about the time of day, because I don't know how many of you have noticed, but the time of day that you take a photo can make that image dramatically different. You could stay in one place for a 20-hour period and you'll get a series of very, very different images that probably won't even look like the same place. I'll talk about too much light versus not enough light. That's always a challenging one, particularly in digital. In film, it can be a little bit easier to recover from not enough light. No one can really recover from too much light. But in digital, it's a little bit harsher. And I'll be talking about soft light and hard light and the difference there. So the first tip I'm going to give you is, during the day, just as a general rule, try and have the sun behind you, or at least to one side of you when you're taking a photo of something. It doesn't really matter what it is. It will look better if the sun's behind you, because you end up generally with a nice blue sky. Your sky and your ground will have a similar sort of exposure level. And you'll not have to resort to tricks. So by tricks, I'm just going to show you this thing. I hope you can see this. If I put it right in front of my head, you'll probably be able to see it. So you notice that the top half of this is gray and the bottom half's not. That's called a graduated neutral density filter. You can use that in situations where the sky's too bright. So I'm not expecting you all to go out and buy those things. It's just a thing that I use when I'm cheating a little bit. But if you keep the sun behind you, you won't need something like that. You'll just be able to shoot this sort of image, which was just straight onto New York from a ferry boat coming back from Statue of Liberty, I think, from memory. And you get nice warm colors along with the blue sky. And you get lots of detail in the photo because there's lots of light. One of the things digital cameras love is lots of light. So remember I talked about the time of the day before? So the sun changes angle throughout the entire day. And I'll get into winter and summer a little bit later, because there is a huge difference between the two. But you start off with pre-dawn light. So that's that lovely sort of deep blue, almost purple colors. And then you get into sunrise, where you get really vibrant reds and oranges if you're facing towards the sun. And away from the sun, you'll probably get pinks and purples and blues and all sorts of interesting colors. They can happen facing the sun as well, but you might not see it so much because the sun's so bright. Then you get into what's called the golden hour, and I'll give examples of each of these things shortly. And the golden hour is the time that people love to go out and shoot people, because it's really good to take people out into the landscape and take pictures of them in that time. The one thing that you want to watch is your camera will probably confuse the white balance during the golden hour, but you can fix that later on when you come back, particularly if you're shooting raw. I don't recommend that you change your white balance to anything in particular when you're shooting in the golden hour, because it's pretty hard to guess what you should actually use. If you do want to do that, set it into a manual one, use the live view on your camera if it supports it, and just see what it looks like and try and get a color balance that looks similar to what's around you. Then we get into daytime. Now, early in the day, daytime's fine. But when you get towards the middle of the day, when the sun's at its highest point in the sky, daytime is a bit yuck. It's a bit hard to see anything. You get very, very strong, harsh shadows. And if you're shooting things like buildings or trees or people, you'll end up with shadows in strange places that make them look quite different. Now, for maps purposes, would you not take a photo of a building that you want to put onto maps in the middle of the day? No, of course not, because it's not going to matter that much for maps. You don't have to be artistically creative or artistically perfect for it. But for your other sorts of shots that you're taking for yourself, it's worth thinking about avoiding it if you can. So if you're traveling, you probably haven't got a choice, but if you could go there at a different time of day, I would suggest that you should. And guess what happens at the other end of the day? Same thing, except it goes the other way. So you head back from daytime in the late afternoon and early evening, usually fairly nice light to shoot with, except perhaps in the middle of summer, but we'll get into that later. Then you get into the golden hour again. Now, the golden hour in the afternoon, same name as the golden hour in the morning. The light's a little bit different, though, and doesn't make that much difference to your shots, but just be aware of it. Now, if you're trying to find out when these times are, there's a lot of apps out there. My favorite one is called the Photographer's Ephemeris, which is TPE. So if you Google TPE in your app store or on websites, then you'll find that. And that tells you not only when the sunset and sunrise happen and all of the other time frames, but it also tells you what direction the sun's going to come from. Now, then we get into sunset. You can get some amazing colors in sunset, very similar to the ones you got in the morning. Surprise. And then you get into twilight, which is fairly similar to the pre-dawn. And depending on the time of year, the twilight can last quite a long time. There's also two twilights. There's the normal twilight and one called nautical twilight. So nautical twilight is when the sun has well and truly gone behind the horizon, and the normal twilight is just as it goes behind the horizon. I assume it makes a difference if you're on a ship. It's probably the name. Now, pre-dawn and twilight, you can treat them fairly similarly. They're both a very soft light. You'll get lots of blues and purples in your shots. The colors are very pastel-like, so they're very gentle colors. You probably get no shadows at all. And you'll have low light levels, so you'll need to do generally a long exposure. Now, this can work really well if you're down at the beach or something like that, because you can do some amazing things with long exposures with water. In this particular example, and I'm sure Ollie's probably going a bit crazy right now because maybe he recognizes where this is. This is a place called Nugget Point in Queenstown. And this was the view from my hotel that I have to thank the person over there, my wife, for booking, because it was bloody awesome. And we woke up to this view every day, but this is actually pre-dawn. I know it looks like the sun's up, but that's just the beauty of overexposing a shot in a digital camera. So there's nice greens and blues in this shot. There's no shadows at all. And it's a nice long exposure. So that river, which is actually quite a violent river, the Shotover River, I don't know if you've all seen them, but a lot of people have probably seen those jet boats that go hooning up and down that river. They went right past our hotel. And it's quite a violent, rapid river. Then we get into twilight. And this is from the same place. So the light's slightly different because I've exposed a little bit differently, not as long. It's also become cloudy at that time. It snowed that night. So you're getting some nice mists in the valley there because the cold air is starting to settle. And whenever you're around water, you'll often get mists when the cold air comes. And you'll see there's a lot more yellowy and red tones in the trees immediately outside the hotel. That's probably the light from the hotel rooms affecting that. So you wouldn't normally see that at that time, because you can't see that in the other trees in the background. Now, again, no shadows, and again, it's a long exposure. So when I'm talking about a long exposure, I didn't actually look at the metadata on these, but these would have been more than 20 seconds. So you're going to need a tripod. You're probably not going to be able to do it with a phone, although I've seen some recently that seem to be getting quite good at long exposure, but they're still not good at stabilizations. You still need something to hold on to it. And we get into sunrise and sunset. So sunrise, you start with soft light and it becomes harder. Sunset, you start with hard light and it becomes softer. So I know that's a little bit hard to visualize. And the best thing I can suggest you do is at sunset, actually take some pictures and just make every 3 to 5 minutes or so, take a picture of something and just look at the progression. So I'll leave you guys to do that. You'll get lots of oranges and reds. You'll get quite long shadows that you need to keep an eye on, and you'll see why in a moment. And a big difference between lit and unlit areas, and that's where these beasts, that grey thing I showed you before, can come in handy, because what that's for, you put the grey across the really bright area, and you put the clear part against the darker area, and it just helps even it out a little bit so your camera can cope with it better. And you get some amazing sky colors. Not always, but often. So at sunrise, in this particular shot, the sun's coming up off to the side. This is Lake Wakatipu in New Zealand. It's very near Queenstown. So you see lots of beautiful reds and orange hues. And in this particular case, the sun's hit the mountains, but it hasn't hit the water yet. So it's lighting up from behind the hill on the left-hand side. So you can see the distant mountains are getting quite nicely lit up. But there's still enough light to get lots of structure, and you're getting some nice reflections of the sky and the clouds in the water. Sadly, it wasn't a particularly still day, or it would have been even better. And I'm going to show you a couple of sunset shots. This first one is shooting into the sun. Remember I said don't do that? I do it all the time. It actually yields quite nice effects. You can get some very interesting lens flares. You can see a bit of a halo. In fact, you can see three lines of halo to the left of the sun. There's a very bright one, then there's a faint one, and then there's a more wishy-washy one around to the side. But you can also see what the sun's doing to the distant mountains. You can see the quite strong yellow light on the fire tower, and you can see how it's highlighting the leaves, which I quite like. It does mean that the rest of the image goes quite dark though. Don't go home after the sun has set. So this is a good half hour from the same place after the sun set. The fire tower is off to the right in this shot. And you can see that you've got all these nice blues and purples, and you're starting to get blacks coming through in the mountains. And you can get some really cool layered effects here. Now, these shots are nice by themselves. I really like this sort of landscape shot, but they can also be useful for backgrounds if you're doing portrait photos and things like that you can use as your background for the people. We've got golden hour. So this is approximately an hour after sunrise and an hour before sunset. And I say approximately because it really depends where you are in the world. I mean, some of you are in the tropics, you're near the equator. It's going to be quite different for you how long that time period is. I think it's the further away you are from the equator, the longer it is from memory, but not 100% sure on that one. But the light is usually softer during that time. You've got very warm, natural colors happening, long shadows, and it's really great for photographing people, food, and structures. So if you're sitting in an outdoor cafe during golden hour, you'll get some very different shots to what you would during the day. And I said it's great for people and sun and landscapes. This is a bride who's being photographed on the mountains of New Zealand. It's near Skipper's Point. It's one of those interesting places. If you try and go there, there's this massive sign that says, if you're driving a rental car, turn around now because you don't have insurance anymore. You go anyway. Don't tell anyone. So, but you've got to watch those shadows. So you can see some shadows on her gown that are happening in there, but you can also see the shadows starting to appear on the landscape in the background, which make the landscape look quite different. But you can also see that there's very, very warm tones. In the hour immediately after sunrise, it's a little bit different. So you get some nice warm colors like we got here, a deep blue sky, if it's not cloudy, and you get great structure in your images. So what do I mean by structure? In this image, because you've got quite a lot of light, the camera is doing a really good job at discerning all those individual leaves and discerning the wires in the bridge. And the wires are all lit up by the sun. So you can see on one side they're quite bright and the other side they're quite dark. So it gives you this really nice contrast that makes them easy to see. So you've probably seen lots of photos of the Brooklyn Bridge. If the people that took them went there at this time of day, they'd be much happier with the shots that they take at 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock in the afternoon. Now, daytime, so this is both after the golden hour and before the golden hour again. So you'll get the soft tending towards hard and then back to soft light. You tend to get high contrast and hard shadows and natural colors, but too much light can wash out the features, particularly in the sky. And the morning and afternoons are the best times for the photography then. Avoid during the day. You should go inside and have a nice lunch somewhere. So some of you probably recognize this person. It's Tracy Capiello, who's one of the people who runs Local Guides and runs Connect for us. And I was fortunate enough to go and have breakfast with her one day in Brooklyn. It's great light for people, so you can see it. It's quite kind to both of us. I mean, I'm kind of old and craggy, and in that photo, I don't look that old and craggy anymore. But you've got to watch those shadows. You notice that's a selfie with the phone, and what's on my face? Shadow from the phone. Did I even notice at that time? Yeah. And to be honest, in that sort of shot, I don't really care because it's capturing a moment with a friend. It's not needing an important New York shot or whatever. But because the sun's so bright, I am a bit squinty. So you need to watch that if you're shooting people. It's difficult for a person to look into the sun while you're taking their picture, even though their picture will be better when they're looking into the sun. You have to think of their comfort. Now, lunchtime. So if you're taking shots at midday, and if you're traveling overseas, you probably can't avoid this. So on this particular day, we're in Central Park. I wanted to take a picture of the Ghostbusters building across the lake because, you know, good movie. Watch it if you haven't. The original, the others are crap. Just got someone joining us late. So midday does give you kind of boring images. You notice there's almost no tone in that building. There's not a lot of contrast. There's not much structure there. You can discern that the building's there. You can see some shapes and things like that, but you can't make out individual bricks or anything like that in the shot. And the sky's quite washed out. So you might remember that shot I showed you of the bridge earlier in the morning. Actually, I'm going forwards, want to go backwards, that one. That sky was really bright. It's the same day. It's only a couple of hours later, and we get that one. So that's purely because of the height of the sun in the sky. Winter time is quite different. So winter time, you can get away with shooting at midday normally, most of the time. So this was about May, so it's certainly approaching winter. And it's more like a summer morning because the sun's really low in the sky. If you remember that diagram I had with the sun going over the top, it never really makes it to the top of the sky so much because it's lower down. You still get that nice deep blue sky that you get in the mornings, usually, and you get nice warm tones, but you still get the long shadows that time of day can give you. So this is a steamboat that's on Lake Wakatipu in New Zealand. Encourage you to ride it if you go there. It's an awesome experience. It's probably one of the fastest steamboats I've ever been on. Now, when we talked about daytime, we're talking about really harsh light. An overcast day can eliminate that to some extent. So an overcast day, you can still end up with nice, softer and more even light. excuse me. I'll cut this bit out of the video later when I've got a frog in my throat. But on the overcast days, you can get a softer, more even light. You get much lower contrast, natural colours. You may not get any shadows at all, or they may be very soft if you are getting them. And almost any time during the day on an overcast day is fine for photography. The one thing you'll have to watch is that you do have less light. So you need to try and do other things to keep your shutter speed up. So you remember last week we talked about increasing your ISO so that you can have more sensitivity on the sensor. You may need to do that on an overcast day if you want to stop things moving and stop action. I don't know if you can see Busy in the background, but I think she's about to cough something up on the carpet. So overcast days are awesome for shooting shots of people. So this was the New York 36 walk, which was nearly all Googlers came to this and one local guide. So you can see that all of the people are lit quite evenly, even the two of us wearing hats, but you get a really boring sky and there's quite low contrast in the image. So the people stand out quite nicely, but the things behind them don't look so good. But that can be handy with portraits because you want to distract people away from the background because you want them to look at the people. Overcast days are very good for things like street art and for picking up the colour on buildings. So in this shot, this was at about 11:30, 12 o'clock. There's nice even light right throughout the whole scene. There's almost no contrast. There's almost no shadows. And you get lots of nice natural colours coming through in the flowers and the growth that's there and the street art that's erected in that particular place. So that's a place called the High Line in New York. So if you ever go to that city, walk the High Line. It's a really different experience to the rest of the city.